We now move to First Minister's questions. Question one, Kezia Dugdale.
To ask the First Minister what engagement she has planned for the rest of the day.
First Minister.
Engagements to take forward the Government's programme for Scotland.
Kezia Dugdale.
For months, teachers have been telling SNP Government ministers about problems with the new national exams. In February, teachers told this Parliament it could be a catastrophe. Head teachers warned of a disaster. They asked to delay the new hires, and ministers chose to ignore those warnings. Last week, it all ended in tears, specifically the tears of pupils trying to sit higher maths, which has widely been condemned as flawed and too difficult. Over 17,000 pupils and parents have signed a petition in protest. What has the First Minister done about it?
First Minister.
Well, firstly, I think the picture that Kezia Dugdale seeks to paint of our exams is an unfair one. It's an unfair one to pupils who are studying so hard right now for those exams. We know that the annual exam diet is a tense time for students and their parents, and young people work hard throughout the year, and I don't think they deserve that kind of characterisation of the system. Now, obviously, we are aware of concerns that have been expressed about the recent higher mathematics exam, and we take these concerns very seriously. The Scottish Qualifications Authority is responsible for ensuring that exams are set fairly and that they are set to the correct standards. It's also responsible for ensuring that rigorous processes in place to ensure that candidates are in place to ensure that candidates get fair treatment every year and that standards are maintained. And the SQA has assured us, and more importantly, assured the people of Scotland that no candidate will be disadvantaged if any exam paper is proven to be more demanding than it was intended to be. That's why those processes are in place. They're in place every year, and they're there to make sure that our students who work so hard get the best treatment, because that's what they deserve.
Kezia Dugdale.
With respect, Presiding Officer, it is the concerns of teachers and parents that I'm bringing to this chamber. But the First Minister is right. The SQA have said they'll change the pass marks, but changing the pass mark can only help candidates who tried the questions. Those who were too upset to complete the exam or spent too long trying to interpret the questions will get no benefit whatsoever. But that's the SQA's answer. I asked what the First Minister is doing about it, because the Minister is perfectly happy to sit back and allow the Scottish Qualifications Authority to attract all the accusations and criticism. It was the Minister who forced the authority to introduce the new examination, and the Minister should have been able to prevent such a deplorable outcome. Now, I hear the SNP backbenches aren't happy with that, but those are not my words. Those are the words of Nicola Sturgeon when she was Shadow Education Minister back in the last SQA crisis. So does the First Minister agree with Nicola Sturgeon that politicians should stop passing the buck?
First Minister.
Well, of course, what Kezia Dugdale is referring to there is the episode under the last Labour government when there was a comprehensive failure of the administration of the exam system. What we are talking about here is the content of the exam paper in a particular subject. Now, I'm sure, at least I hope it's the case, that Kezia Dugdale is not seriously suggesting that the First Minister, or indeed any other politician, should either set or mark the exams that our young people sit. Now, the SQA, the responsibility of the SQA is to ensure that exams are set to the correct standard. The SQA has given assurance that the live question paper for the maths exam was designed according to the course assessment specification for higher maths. It was developed by experienced teachers, and both the current and the new higher maths papers were overseen by the same principal assessor. But more importantly, as I said in my original answer, the SQA issued a statement last week making clear that it has not new processes in place to take account of this. It has standard processes in place place to moderate results each year if a paper proves either to be unexpectedly difficult or unexpectedly easy. And the point of that is to ensure that consistent standards are maintained year on year. The SQA has also emphasised that no candidate will be disadvantaged if this year's exam is proven to be too difficult. And the SQA also said, as I would assume Kezia Dugdale would know, that it will take account of pupils sitting that exam who were distressed because they thought it was more difficult than expected. So these are the processes that are in place to ensure that we have a consistent and a consistently high standard exam system. It is right that it's overseen by the professional SQA, and I would assume that that assurance would be positive for Kezia Dugdale and, more importantly, for parents and pupils across the country to hear.
Kezia Dugdale.
President Officer, we're talking about the future prospects of thousands of children across Scotland. And in January, I alerted the First Minister to the fact that the SQA appeal system is not fit for purpose. Access to it now depends on a school's ability to pay, and appeals have been replaced by reviews and remarks, which take no account of circumstances on exam day. Parents in private schools are paying for a second mark of their children's exams. They can even pay extra for a priority review for just £39.75 as advertised on the SQA website. The appeal system is about to be tested to destruction by this year's higher maths exam. Yep. It's been 4 months since I last raised this. Has the First Minister done anything to fix this unfair and unjust system?
First Minister. Order. First Minister.
The implication lying behind Kezia Dugdale's question here that somehow better off parents can buy better exam results for their children is simply not true. The SQA introduced its new post-results service in 2014 to replace the former appeals system. The new service is actually the result of very wide-ranging consultation between the SQA, schools, colleges and other education professionals who all recognised that a review of the appeal service was required. The new service was introduced precisely so that there was a fairer, more rigorous system in place. But can I say to Kezia Dugdale, and I say this in all sincerity, you know, these are important issues. I don't for a second deny or demur from that point. But it is not fair. It's not fair to pupils around this country right now to come here with particular concerns, such as the concern over the higher maths paper, which has been addressed and will be addressed by the Scottish Qualifications Authority, and somehow suggest that our entire exams system is flawed. Now, why is that not fair? Because that undermines the efforts and is in danger of undermining the results of those students who have worked so hard to achieve exam passes. So where issues are raised by pupils and by parents, as was the case with the maths exam, they will be addressed and they will be responded to. And we will do that responsibly, and we'll do that while still wishing all of the students across the country who are still sitting exams the very best of success.
The First Minister questions the unfairness of this. Perhaps I can remind her of what Larry Flanagan said when I last brought this up. Appeals should be based upon the professional judgment of teachers rather than on the wishes of the parent, and what is now happening is fundamentally wrong. There are serious concerns and she should reflect on that. We heard this week that 25% of medical students come from private schools. Some of the pupils defeated by this unfair exam in maths and those sitting chemistry today might have been hoping to change that. They are afraid that their chance could be gone, and so are their parents. The backbenches are guffawing, but here's a couple of quotes. Chloe Thompson from Hoyk: I have studied very hard all year in preparation for my exams in the hope of attaining 5 A's in order to apply to university to study medicine. This dream now seems completely out of reach due to the awful maths exam I endured yesterday. Alana McCrone from Dumfries: my son studied hard for this exam. He came home devastated afterwards, and this has added to extra stress to him as he still has exams to sit. The First Minister took 2 pages of the Daily Record this week to tell us how well she was served by the education system, but perhaps she should worry more about what's happening in our schools today. The appeal system and the new exams need sorted out. She said education is her sacred responsibility. Surely it's time for some divine intervention from this First Minister.
First Minister.
It It's very clear indeed that Kezia Dugdale was not listening to a word that I said in my earlier answers. Or maybe she was listening and just couldn't change her script to respond to it. But Kezia Dugdale read out the very distressed comments of somebody who had sat the higher maths paper. And I, you know, have huge sympathy for anybody who sits an exam and comes out of it feeling like that. But surely Kezia Dugdale's responsibility is to relay back to that young person the assurances and reassurances that the SQA has given and that I have outlined in this chamber today. Let me repeat it. No young person sitting the higher maths exam will be disadvantaged if it is found out that the exam was more difficult than intended. And how can we say that with confidence? Because the SQA has the processes in place every single year to moderate results, to take account of the fact that an exam might be found to be easier or harder than was intended. Those are the systems that are in place precisely to protect against the understandable fears that that young person has expressed. But instead of trying to play up those fears, surely Kezia Dugdale's responsibility is to join us in reassuring that young person. And I think that would be more responsible. And on in relation to... I don't think Labour members who are shouting abuse across the chamber right now are remotely interested in the fortunes of our young people. As always, the top priority of Labour members is simply to hurl abuse at the SNP, and that will not be lost in anyone. I wanted to come on to the second substantive and important point that Kezia Dugdale raised around the new system for appeals. Now, as with all SQA charges, and it's important to emphasise this, local authorities will meet the costs of requests by any public sector schools to use the service. The Association of Directors of Education in Scotland made clear in a statement back in February that no young person will be disadvantaged under the new system. Head teachers are also clear that decisions are made on an educational basis, not on a cost basis. Ken Cunningham, the General Secretary of School Leaders Scotland, he said the decision to appeal will not be reached based on looking at the books, but on what schools feel is right for their pupils. Those are the kind of assurances that are important for our young people. And instead of trying to scaremonger, Labour should be doing their bit to get these assurances out there.
Question two, Ruth Davidson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister when she will next meet the Secretary of State for Scotland.
First Minister.
No current plans.
Ruth Davidson.
Thank you. The First Minister is meeting parents from the Fair Funding for Our Kids programme today, which is a campaign group dedicated to ensuring that promises made on childcare are actually delivered. We spoke to them this morning and they raised the case of a single mum in Glasgow called Marisa. She's working now, but last year when she tried to get back to work, she had to turn down three separate jobs because she was restricted to 3 hours nursery each morning for her four-year-old daughter. For a woman trying to get back into the workplace, that's not good enough. She needs to be able to fit the hours of nursery around the demands of her job, not have to reject jobs to fit around nursery hours. Parents should be able to take their free nursery hours whenever they want and wherever they want. And surely the First Minister would agree with that.
First Minister.
Yeah, I do have a lot of sympathy with that. On the case that Ruth Davidson has cited, she's absolutely right to say that I, with the Education Secretary, will be meeting Fair Funding for Our Kids later this afternoon. This will be the second time that I have met them. I'm very happy to take the case study that Ruth Davidson has cited and look into that in particular. I mean, let's put this issue into context. We have, as a government, increased entitlement to childcare for 3 and 4 year olds by almost half, up from 412 and a half hours when we took office to 600 hours a year right now. We've got ambitions to go even further. That commitment is fully funded. Uptake is high. Every child is offered a place. There is certainly no evidence to suggest that children are not offered places. But that said, I do appreciate, and this is the substance of the discussions that I'll be having with Fair Funding for Our Kids later, that some parents believe there is insufficient flexibility and choice in the implementation by local authorities to enable them to take up their entitlement. You know, for example, a patient who is offered a place at a council nursery that perhaps doesn't suit their working patterns and then can't get funding in a partnership nursery. So we've given a commitment to look firstly at how we improve the gathering of data so that we can get a better idea of the extent of that particular issue, but secondly to look at how we work with local authorities to make sure there is increasing levels of flexibility and choice in the system. There are examples of very good practice already around the country. I would commend to Ruth Davidson the examples of the council in this city in Edinburgh and Dumfries and Galloway Council, who, you know, offer places in any of their partnership nurseries as long as a place is available. So we will continue to look at how we improve the system. But let's be clear, Presiding Officer, these are issues that arise out of an expanding system. Yes. They are issues arising because we are improving the provision of childcare, and we will continue to do that.
Ms. Davidson. Once again, we seem to have an acknowledgement of an issue, warm words, someone else's problem, but no actual clear plan. And listening to the First Minister just then, it is no wonder that Fair Funding for Our Kids said just this morning there is a great deal of smoke and mirrors around the free nursery policy. No one is on top of how it is being delivered. And I tell you what, it's certainly not delivering for people like Marissa. And as always, it's not the better off families that are hurt most. It's the single parents or the families on low incomes who have no other options. The 600 hours of childcare is there to help families, but it's only a help if they can choose when to take it. So can the First Minister give us assurance that we've had enough of the smoke and mirrors and that when she meets parents today, she will simply promise them something like more flexibility and a real plan on its delivery?
First Minister.
I don't expect the leaders of any of the opposition parties to listen to my answers and then treat them fairly, but I think any objective person listening to the answer I gave to Ruth Davidson would not have heard me say it's someone else's problem. They would have heard me talk in quite some detail about the work that we are seeking to do with councils, because councils are statutorily responsible for implementing early care. And there are many parties across this chamber who frequently, wrongly, accuse this government of being centralising. Exactly. But then when we trust local authorities to implement policies, they tell us we should centralise the responsibility. So they should make up their mind what side of this they're on. But Ruth Davidson is right. This is an issue of real importance to parents in Scotland. The vast majority of parents are accessing and benefiting from the policy that's in place. There are a small number of parents who believe that there is not sufficient flexibility in the system. Now, we need to understand exactly how many that is, and that's why I've committed to the further work. But on an ongoing basis, we're seeking to introduce that greater flexibility. We've introduced a statutory responsibility on local authorities to consult parents about the flexibility that is required. And as I have already said, many councils across the country are already delivering this policy in a more flexible way than some others. So this is ongoing work, and we'll go on with doing it and let the opposition carp.
Jenny Mara.
The First Minister knows that porters from Nine Wells Hospital are in a long-running pay dispute. They are being paid less than other porters in NHS Tayside hospitals. This is a matter of fairness. The porters are here in Parliament today. Will the First Minister now ask NHS Tayside to bring in ACAS to resolve this dispute fairly and let the porters get back to work?
First Minister.
Well, firstly, can I take the opportunity to welcome the Tayside porters to the gallery today? They are a fantastic bunch of people. I had the privilege of meeting some of them when I attended the STUC Congress a few weeks ago. But more importantly than that, they, with porters right across the National Health Service, do an absolutely fantastic job. They are often amongst the unsung heroes of our health service, the people without whom the health service wouldn't be able to deliver the excellent patient care that it does. Now, as Jenny Mara will be aware, discussions around this particular dispute are ongoing, and the Scottish Terms and Conditions Committee, STAC, which is the appropriate body within the National Health Service bargaining framework, is involved, has spoken to both sides, has had a number of exchanges over the past 2 weeks, and I'm very hopeful that that process will lead to a resolution. I think it's right and proper that we allow it to reach its due course, but I'm hopeful it will lead to that successful resolution, and I hope all of us will join with us today in thanking not just the Tayside porters, but porters everywhere across our National Health Service.
Jimmy McGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To relieve Scottish fishermen from the financial burden of new EU rules on the discarding of fish, Ian Duncan MEP secured a change in EU law ensuring that the Scottish Government covers the cost of transporting and storing unsellable catch. However, it's emerged from correspondence with the Shetland Fishermen's Association that Marine Scotland is refusing to foot the bill despite its new obligation under EU law. Can the First Minister explain why the Scottish Government will not support Scottish fishermen? And can she further explain why, in not complying with the law, the Scottish Government is willing to pay financial penalties to Brussels that are greater than the cost of supporting the Scottish fishermen in the first place?
First Minister.
Okay, Jimmy McGregor raises what certainly sounds like an important and serious issue. I will undertake to him today to look into this issue, to discuss it with the Fishing Secretary, who's sitting a couple of rows behind me in the chamber right now, and we will write to the member with a detailed answer to the question. And if the member, when he receives that detailed explanation, wants to meet with Richard Lockhead, Richard Lockhead will be very happy to meet with him.
Nigel Dawn.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The First Minister will be aware of a very serious road accident that occurred on the A90 in my constituency at the Lawrence Church South Junction last Friday, and I'm sure she shares my concern for those who were affected by it. Given that this junction has already been identified as one that does need to be grade separated, can the First Minister give me any assurance of how quickly that will be done, please?
First Minister.
Well, my first thoughts, and I'm sure this is the case for everybody across the chamber, are with the individuals involved in this accident, and I extend my very best wishes to those who were injured for a speedy and full recovery. Now, the circumstances of the particular accident that the member raises will obviously need to be fully investigated, and he will know, though, that the Scottish Government, working alongside Nestrands, Angus and Aberdeenshire councils, are currently examining whether improvements are required to the Lawrencekirk junction. Indeed, Transport Scotland will publish a study next month, which will then help to inform how access to that junction can be improved. And when that study is published, I know that the Transport Minister will be very happy to meet with Nigel Dawn to discuss it further.
Question 3, Willie Rennie.
To ask the First Minister what issues will be discussed at the next meeting of the Cabinet.
First Minister.
Matters of importance to the people of Scotland.
Willie Rennie.
A Freedom of Information request has found that 350,000 Scottish photographs have been added to the Police National Database. The Biometric Commissioner has concerns about accessing that database using new facial recognition technology that does not have legal underpinning. Does the First Minister agree with the Biometric Commissioner?
First Minister.
Well, in all of these things, the right balance has to be struck between the need to protect the public and keep communities safe and the need to safeguard the rights of individuals. Police Scotland operates in accordance with human rights and data protection legislation. Scottish legislation regulates the information that is uploaded by Police Scotland and how long that information is kept for. Legislation also outlines the alignment of case information and associated retention periods of these records. So there are rules, regulations and safeguards in place. In terms of the particular issue about facial recognition that Willie Rennie raises, I mean, he will be aware, and I understand that the way in which Police Scotland uses this, I understand this, is more restrictive than certain other police forces in other parts of the UK. It's only images of those who are either convicted of or arrested and or charged with an offence whose image would be uploaded to the Police National Database, and it's only images of those convicted that will be kept on the database. So, you know, I think when we look at that balance between the need to protect the public and the very important need to protect civil liberties, it strikes me that we've got it right in this case. But of course, these things continue and always will continue, rightly so, to be kept under review.
Willie Rennie.
Can I thank the First Minister for that answer? But my question is not about the retention of the photographs in the database. It's about the photographs taken to check against the database that we are concerned about. There are strict rules on taking fingerprints and DNA to check against those databases, but the same rules do not apply to the photograph database. The concern is people's privacy. If the police can take photographs at, say, football matches or political demonstrations to compare those photographs with the database using this new technology, their safeguards are in place. They're in place for fingerprints and DNA. Does the First Minister think there are adequate safeguards covering photographs too?
First Minister.
I'm very happy to look at that particular point in more detail and perhaps correspond or discuss this with Willie Rennie in the future. I suspect, although these are matters for frontline police officers and those involved in the investigation and detection of crime, but you know, perhaps most routinely it will be images from CCTV cameras that will be used to try and identify people through the images held on the Police National Database. Now, I'm only speaking personally here, but if I or a member of my family was, for example, the victim of an assault in the street and there was CCTV images of somebody who there was a suspicion might be guilty of that, I think I would want that to be Absolutely. Used to see if we could identify the perpetrator Absolutely. Of that crime. So let's not lose sight here of the purpose and the objective of this. It's to apprehend and bring to justice criminals. And in my view, that's a good thing. But yes, civil liberties and human rights are important. And as technology advances, we have to keep the ways in which we protect those civil liberties under review, and we will always do that. So I'll look at the particular point raised by Willie Rennie and come back to him perhaps with some more detail once I've had the opportunity to consider it.
Question 4, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what the Scottish Government's response is to the Queen's speech.
First Minister.
Well, the Scottish Government will be a constructive critic of the programme set out in the Queen's speech. The proposals from the UK Government, though, failed to recognise that Tory policies were roundly rejected by the Scottish electorate earlier this month. And where we disagree with the provisions in the Queen's speech, we will make our opposition to these plans very clear. So we will not support policies that continue with austerity. We will not support policies that put more children at risk of poverty. And we won't support policies that put Scotland's membership of the European Union and our valuable human rights protections at risk.
Kenneth Gibson.
I thank the First Minister for that answer. Does she share my concerns that the Scotland Bill published this morning will not deliver the Smith Commission proposals in full as promised, let alone those pledged in the pre-referendum vow?
First Minister.
Well, the UK Government, I think, had a very clear test today to deliver a bill which lived up in full, in spirit and in letter, to the Smith Commission. Now, the bill has been published within the last hour or so, and from my glance at it, I think it falls short in almost every area. The bill, for example, doesn't contain the full welfare powers recommended by the Smith Commission, and in some key powers, it retains, unbelievably in my view, given the amount of concern that was expressed about this, it retains a veto for the UK government on key policy areas. So, for example, if this Parliament wants to abolish the bedroom tax, as I hope we do, the UK government would still have a right of veto over whether we could do it or not. Now, I'm sorry, but that is not devolution. So I hope all parties will support us and indeed support the recommendations of the All-Party Devolution Further Powers Committee as we seek to get a Scotland bill that really does live up to and deliver the Smith recommendations.
Question 5, Jackie Bailey.
To ask the First Minister how much revenue has been raised by the Land and Buildings Transaction Tax and the Landfill Tax since April 2015.
First Minister.
Well, Land and Buildings Transaction Tax was successfully introduced by Revenue Scotland on the 1st of April. Revenue Scotland published its first set of monthly statistics on the 21st of May based on returns submitted in April. These show a successful first month with over 7,500 returns received and almost £18 million collected in tax from residential and non-residential property sales. These results are in line with our expectations. We are, of course, in discussion with the UK Government on the impact of forestalling, which the UK Government has agreed to compensate us for. Scottish landfill tax is collected quarterly, with the first returns due from landfill operators in August this year. Revenue Scotland will publish quarterly statistics for Scottish landfill tax from September 2015. So I'm sure even Jackie Bailey will agree that this is an encouraging beginning for Revenue Scotland, which launched on time and on budget.
Jackie Bailey.
Can I thank the First Minister for her response? If you were to look at the overall figures anticipated by the Cabinet Secretary for Finance, you would probably be looking at figures in relation to about £41 million in the first month of operation. But I absolutely accept house buying is seasonal. There was some forestalling and the figures may well improve. But what it demonstrates is the variability of these taxes as will be the case with the new tax powers in the Scotland Bill. And there is a direct relationship with ensuring continued funding for our public services. So given the importance of this, what capacity is the Scottish Government developing to support better forecasting and a robust fiscal framework?
First Minister.
Well, as Jackie Baillie, I think, rightly acknowledges there, yes, there is variability. That's why we make predictions on the basis we do. In terms of LBDT, the early results are in line with our expectations. We always anticipated a degree of forestalling, which is precisely why the Deputy First Minister is in discussion with the UK Government about how we're compensated for that. In terms of her wider point about how we make sure we have robust information underpinning the modelling and these projections, that's precisely why we are taking steps to put the Scottish Fiscal Commission on a statutory footing and making sure, as we take more responsibility for more tax powers, that the Scottish Fiscal Commission is properly equipped to do that very important job.
Question six, Liz Smith.
To ask the First Minister whether the Scottish Government agrees with the concerns expressed by parents and pupils about the recent SQA Higher Mathematics paper.
First Minister.
Well, as I said earlier on, I think we all know that this time of year with the annual exams is a tense time for students and their parents, but young people work really hard throughout the year, and for many, the exams are the culmination of that hard work. Yes, we are aware of the concerns expressed about the recent higher maths exam, and as I said earlier on in this session, the SQA is responsible for ensuring that exams are set fairly and the correct standards, and to the correct standards, and it has rigorous processes in place to ensure that candidates get fair treatment.
Liz Smith.
I thank the First Minister for that, and I listened extremely carefully to your response to Kezia Dugdale. And I don't think the issue is quite so much that the maths higher was seen as particularly hard, something, as you rightly point out, SQA can address, but that the structure of some of the papers and the style of questioning does not actually appear to be in line with what many schools adopting the new higher had in prelims. So can I ask the First Minister, given that half the schools actually opted to have the old higher, if she thinks that that, combined with the concerns of the criticisms that we've had in this last week, reflect deeper concerns about the deployment of exemplar materials for the exam?
First Minister.
I don't think it necessarily does that, although these will be issues that we want to study very carefully. The double running of the old and new hires this year for 1 year only was as a result of careful discussion and consultation and agreement that that was the right thing to do. Liz Smith, I think, rightly acknowledges that there are processes in place to moderate results based on the difficulty or otherwise of exams compared to what they're intended to do. And of course, if there are other issues raised after the experience of the exam diet this year, the Education Secretary will raise those with SQ, and I'm sure the Scottish Qualifications Authority would be very happy to meet with Liz Smith to discuss those issues in more detail as well.
Thank you. That ends First Minister's questions. We now move to members' business. Members who leave in the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.